In this video, we will be looking at some further ideas on probability. Specifically, we will be looking at three simple ideas, that of independence, which you will be already familiar with from school probability. We will also be looking at conditional independence, which you might or might not be familiar with. And finally, we will be looking at chain rule of probability. So, independence as a notion, all of us know that two random variables are independent means when an event X happens, it has no bearing on whether event Y happens or not. A simple example would be, suppose I toss a coin and it gives heads or tails. This has no bearing on me tossing another coin and what outcome will come out of it. So, such random variables are called independent random variables. And the mathematical condition under which two variables x and y, let us say that they are statistically independent, is p of x y is equal to p of x multiplied by p of y. To be a little bit more precise, we have to use a little bit more formal notation, though the calculation is actually this. You should say that for every possible x which belongs to event x, and every possible value y which belongs to event y. For example, if I am tossing one coin on one hand and another coin on another hand, the event x would be the outcome of the left hand coin, which could be either heads or tails. Similarly, the event on the right hand would be either heads or tails. Now, for each of these events, heads heads, heads tails, tails heads and tails tails, all of them should work out such that p of x comma y, which is the joint probability of x and y, should be the product of the individual probabilities or product of the marginal probabilities, p of x equal to x multiplied by p of y equal to y. Now, we have a simple example, the example that I gave, or you could say x is the event of throw of a dice and y is the event of toss of a coin. So, of course, x can take 6 independent values, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and y has 2 possible values, heads and tails. Now, each of these combinations, you know, 1 and heads, 2 and heads, 3 and heads, etcetera, etcetera, the 12 individual probabilities, all of them should obey this law. Okay, so all those joint probabilities should obey this law, and we know that they will, because notionally, physically, we have an idea obviously that the event x and event y are independent. This definition is also a good idea for you to find out whether two events are independent or not. Suppose, you know, like we saw in the previous video, suppose we have a joint probability table. Know, let us say x has values x1, x2, x3, and y takes values y1 and y2. So, we have all these joint events y2, x2, y2, x3, y2. So, if you draw this and suppose all you have are all these joint probability values, then you can find out the marginal values of probabilities x and y by simply adding these up and then check whether p of x y is a product of p of x and p of y, and that gives you a check for whether the event is, whether the two events are independent or not. Remember that the condition given here is an if and only if condition. Okay. So, if two events are independent, then you will get p of x y is equal to p of x multiplied by p of y, and only if this is true do we consider the two events to be independent. An example of two measurements which are not independent are height and weight, or two random variables which are not independent are height and weight. So, even though, you know, you could have a very tall person who is very, very slim, and you could have a short person who is very, very stout, in general, as height increases, weight will increase. So, the random variables x and y are actually correlated random variables, they are not independent random variables. This definition of independence is equivalent to giving a conditional probability statement also. So, for example, if two events x and y are independent, then I will say that p of y given x is the same as p of y. What does it mean? Physically, it means that the dependence of y on x here, you know, whether y happens or not has no bearing on whether x happens. So, therefore, p of y given x has to be the same as p of y. Equivalently, you could also say that p of x given y is equal to p of x. You can prove this, the equivalent of these two statements, very simply. Remember that p of x comma y by the product rule is of y given x multiplied by p of x. Now, suppose we take this definition of independence, so p of x y is equal to p of x multiplied by p of y, and then you equate the two, you immediately get that p of y given x is equal to p of y. Okay, so, this two statements, at least you can derive this from here, and similarly if you go the reverse direction, you can derive the other one from this. So, the two statements are actually equivalent. Okay. Typically, we denote independence, the notation is x and this is a perpendicular sign y, because we kind of take orthogonal variables as if they were independent variables. Okay. So, please remember this notation. Now, we continue on and look at a slightly more involved notation, that of conditional independence. This is not simple independence, it is conditional independence. The definition is kind of obvious, it is a simple extension of the previous definition that we had, which is that two random variables are x and y are said to be independent given z, okay, given a third variable or a third event, this should be capital Z, if and only if we say, it is a simple extension as I said, p of x and y joint probability given z is equal to p of x given z multiplied by p of y given z. Let us give a more precise definition like we did last time. It is simply an extension, instead of simply saying p of x comma y given z, you say p that the event x or the random variable x takes the value small x, the random variable y takes the value small y, etcetera, etcetera, is like this for all values of x, y and z. So, let us take a few examples in order to clarify this notion of conditional independence. So, here is the first example. So, let us take the case where x is, you know, a dice throw, y is a toss of a coin and z is drawing a card from a deck. In this case, you can see that obviously drawing a card from the deck has no bearing on x or y. Actually, z is, if you take pairwise, y is independent from z, x is also independent from z. Okay. You will also see that automatically p of x comma y is equal to p of x, p of y, because x and y are also independent as we saw earlier. The throw of a dice has nothing to do with a toss of a coin. So, these events x and y are of course independent, they are also conditionally independent in the sense that x comma y given z is the same as x given z and y given z. Why? Because since x and z are independent, then probability of x given z is probability of x, probability of y given z is probability of y, and similarly probability of x comma y given z is probability of x comma y, and the rest of it follows from the fact that x and y are already independent. Okay, so, this is an example where x and y are not only independent, but they are also conditionally independent. Let us take a different example. Let us take the example where x denotes height, y denotes vocabulary of this person of whose height we are measuring. Okay. In this case, let us first ask the question, let us ignore the fact of z, whatever definition I gave for z here, and let us look at is height independent of vocabulary. Now, a priori it looks like it should not matter what a person's height is, you know, the vocabulary is independent of the person's height. However, if I tell you this person is just 2 feet tall, it automatically means, or it is most probable that this person therefore must be a child and therefore must have low vocabulary. So, x and y by themselves, unless I gave some further conditions, are not independent. So, please remember this, in this case x and y are not really independent variables, they are only independent suppose I give a particular condition. So, let us give such a condition, one such condition would be age. So, suppose I say that if I look at all people of age 12, would it matter what the person's height is for the vocabulary, and the answer would be, at least common sense says and our common observation says that this is not true. Similarly, if I fix the age at 30, people of the age of 30 regardless of height will have vocabularies that are whatever they are, they do not at least depend on height. Similarly, if I fix the age at 2, it would not matter what the person's age is or the baby's age is, you know, the height and vocabulary would be independent. It could be a slightly taller child with lesser vocabulary, or it could be a shorter child with more vocabulary, etcetera. Okay. So, this is an example of a case where the two variables are not independent, but they are conditionally independent. Okay. So, if you give a particular condition, they actually become independent. So, let us look at a third case where the two variables were originally independent, but they actually, after you apply a condition, they are no longer independent. So, here is a simple example. I have two dice. I throw one dice and the value I denote as x, or that is the event x. The second dice throw, that is value is y. Okay. And now these two events, as I know, are independent. If I have two different independent dice, I throw them, the value I get on one has no bearing on the value that I get on the other. Okay. But suppose I fix the sum of the dice, okay, and that is the variable z. Then if I find out x comma y given z, the moment I give you the value of x and I give the value of z, the value of y is fixed. Therefore, these events are no longer conditionally independent. Okay. So, here is a case where the events are independent, but after you add a condition, they are no longer independent. Okay. So, conditional independence, as you can see, is a separate idea from that of independence. You can have all sorts of combinations, independent, conditionally not independent, etcetera, etcetera, as we just saw on this slide. The notation that we use for conditional independence is x orthogonal or x perpendicular, that means x independent of y given z. Okay. So, this follows naturally from what we saw in the previous slide. So, let us look at the chain rule of conditional probability. So, remember the product rule that we had for the joint probability p of x given y, this was equal to p of x comma x given y multiplied by p of y. Okay. Now, we might try and extend this to three variables, the joint probability of three variables. Okay. So, let us say you have p of x comma y comma z. A good way to sort of find out the expression for this is to reuse this idea. For this, we denote A as the event y comma z, that means A is the event of y and z occurring together, the joint event y comma z. Okay. So, if we do that, so we can now write p of x comma y comma z is p of x comma a, which by the product rule is simply p of x given a multiplied by p of a. We can open this up. Remember, a was y comma z. So, p of x given a multiplying p of y comma z. We can open up p of y comma z to this once again using the product rule. So, p of y comma z is p of y given z multiplied by p z. Okay. So, notice this result. I am just flipping the whole thing. P of x comma x given y comma z multiplied by p of y given z multiplied by p z. If we reverse this, you can write this as p of z multiplied by p of y given z multiplied by p of x given y and z. Okay, you can see that this is actually a natural interpretation of the probability of all three events x and y and z happening. So, what does this say? This says the probability that x, y, z occur is the probability that z occurs multiplied by the probability of y given that z occurs, then the probability that x happens given that y and z have also occurred. Okay. So, this is a simple interpretation of what happens, and this is why this is an example of the chain rule for three variables. Of course, we can now extend it to n variables in general. So, instead of just three, if you have n events x 1 through x n which occur jointly, you can now write it as the probability that the first event occurs multiplied by the probability that the second event occurs given that the first has occurred, so on and so forth until the probability that the nth event occurs given that the first n minus 1 occur. In compact notation, you can write this as probability the first event occurs multiplied by the product. Remember, pi denotes product. Product of I equals to 2 to n of this event x I given that x1 through xi minus 1 occurred. This is the chain rule of probability. So, here is a simple context where we will be using conditional probabilities later. This is just to give you some look ahead of what will be happening. Let us say you have some such image. This is the image of something called an odd eyed cat. It does occur naturally, even though it looks like a fake image. You have some eye cat with two different eyes, but suppose we ask what is the probability that some such image occurs. Now, remember our idea from the linear algebra videos, that let us say this is a 60 cross 60 image. It has 3600 pixels, first pixel, 60th pixel, so on and so forth up till the 3600th pixel. So, what I want is basically the probability that all these pixels take the given intensities that they have taken. So, we can think of this image now as a single event of the first pixel taking the value x1, second pixel taking the value x2, so on and so forth till the 3600th pixel taking the value x3600. And how do we find this out? You can basically think of this as a joint probability, and now you can rewrite using the chain rule that we just wrote, what the probability will be. This probability is equivalent to p of x1 multiplied by p of x2 given x1, so on and so forth, p of x 3600 given 1, 2 up till 3599. Now, in addition to this, if we somehow got to use independence of conditional independence, which we will also do later using some kind of machine learning models, you will see that this whole expression can be simplified tremendously. So, this is one context. This is not the only context where we will be using conditional probabilities and the chain rule, but this is one context where we can use this very, very conveniently.